away. Hi.
No, I'm not doing push-ups or something.
Are you not?
Apparently not.
No, good. It's Def Leppard release day, and that's a great thing. October the 30th, 2015, brand new album out today. Doing very well worldwide. We've already got some numbers in, haven't we?
Yeah.
Number one, number two, number one. Actually, number one in 9 out of 10 territories so far in Europe, which is fantastic. And that's just after about 12 hours. So thank you for all your support. We are here to answer your questions, as many as we can. It's a very busy day. We're going to get as many in as we can, so we'll keep them short and sweet. We're going to take some later on off Periscope. We're going to do some now, aren't we?
I think, yes, off sheets of paper.
The old-fashioned way of doing things.
Analog.
Analog questions. Now,
so will you tour your next album?
Yeah, we start our world tour in about a week and a half in Tokyo, Japan, the 9th of November. So yes, we're going to tour the album, that's when we start. And wherever you live, hopefully we'll get there as well.
I've got one here from somebody called, excuse me, my eyesight's not as good as it was 25 years ago. Richard Pinio. With the release of the new album, Close, does this change your view on making albums, etc.? Well, our view on making albums obviously changes day by day, because up until making this album, we weren't even making an album. So we thought we'd do an EP, 3 tracks maybe, like we did on the end of Mirrorball, 3 new songs, put them out on the internet, see what happened. But we went in, started writing, and then we ended up with 12 songs, and then we ended up with 14. So we couldn't really pick 3, we liked them all. So we decided the album is not dead, make an album, and here we are.
And on that note, Krista Chadwick-White and Jennifer Simpson are asking what songs are your favourites. They're all our favourites, so you can't really do that. So I'll go to the next question, which is what's the hardest part about making this new album, from Katie Pora. And it wasn't hard at all. It was probably the most fun we've had making an album. It was pure inspiration, so it wasn't hard. None of it was hard. It was actually great. We've done it over 3 segments. February 2014, May 2014 for a part, and then June.
Yeah, I did. Went home after the Kiss tour, did bits and bobs, wrote some lyrics that were missing. We sent emails back and forth. We sent MP3s back and forth. We had so much fun making this record. We did some of it the standard way, which is 5 of us all in one room playing live, recording it through a mixing desk into a, well, not tape recorders anymore, but into a laptop or into some digital hard drive. And then we did some work in various hotel rooms around the world. In fact, if I remember correctly, when we played a gig called the Mohegan Sun, which is in Uncasville in Connecticut, about June or July this year, we were still doing backing vocals on the song Let's Go. That's how we can make records these days. Technology is our friend. So you're not stuck to being in Abbey Road. If you want to make an album that sounds like you're in Abbey Road, you can actually do it on a MacBook Pro just as easily. And that's why it's been so much fun to do, because we wrote the songs. We really enjoyed the songwriting process. It was a real lot of fun. But the recording was the most fun I've ever had making a record.
Yeah, me too.
35 years.
There you go.
Next question. I believe it's me, Phil. A guy called David Goolsby. How many new tracks could we be hearing live on the tour? That will change as we develop. The moment we're playing one, by the time we get to Tokyo we'll be playing 2. By the time we get to the UK we have no idea. We should be working on them. We haven't got the luxury that most bands have of locking themselves away in a room for a month and rehearsing for the tour. We're actually having to practice the songs during the sound checks, which only gives us about 15 minutes, or doing it in dressing rooms or in hotel rooms. So it's a whole new way of working, which is interesting when you've been doing it for 35 years. But yeah, we're going to keep adding as they become known. We don't want to overindulge, because even with a song like Let's Go, which is number one all over America on rock radio, it's still only number one on rock radio in certain areas. So we could play for under 10,000 people, still only 150 people have ever heard it so far. So you've got to be very careful that you don't overindulge. So we've got to nurse them into the set over a period of time.
Right, Doreen Close here. Would you ever consider writing a Christmas song, a rocking Def Leppard Christmas song? Funny enough.
I see that.
Delta Deep just recorded a song called Take Me Home for Christmas that we're actually going to release just before Christmas. So I was just going to do that. But Def Leppard did do a Christmas song.
Did they?
Yes. A very metal Christmas.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
So we actually had this song when we was doing the Slang album, and it was left over, and Joe wrote these lyrics, and we could never listen to the song again for about 12 years. Because it was tarnished, because it was a comedy song. It was a very metal Christmas.
Yeah, it was. I sang it like the legendary Jake Thackeray, didn't I?
It was great.
It was pretty grim.
But, it's recorded, right?
Yeah, I have. And if it ever leaks onto the internet, I will kill you.
Absolutely. I won't sneak it out, honestly. But yeah, it's great. So yeah, Delta Deep, we've got one coming out very soon.
Okay, Ruth Slaney, looking back over your career, which song is your most proud, or which song are you most proud of and why? Well, that changes every day, like your socks and your pants, I think. It's hard to argue with things like Photograph as a song, because it was our first massive hit in the States. Animal was our first big hit in the UK. I still think that's a great song, love doing it live. But from an audience reaction point of view, you can't argue with Pour Some Sugar on Me, because just the reaction you get from an audience. But it changes on a daily basis. But those three are three pretty good examples.
Right.
Phil, you're on.
I am. Hang on, let me turn my page. You got stuck. This is Timmy Grayson. How do you approach writing a guitar solo for a song? Do you write it, or do you just go for it and see what happens? Depends on what the song is. Sometimes they just come along, sometimes you hum it along, sometimes you just play it and it happens, and other times you actually go, this needs to be like a vocal, and you must be very aware that you're not going to step on a vocal or a melody or part of the song. It should enhance the song. Therefore, it should be, you should think about it. You can do it straight off the cuff, but it's better if it's actually thought out and it's actually part of the songwriting process, not just off the cuff and showing off.
Which makes it a memorable guitar song.
Absolutely.
Lesson for all you upcoming guitarists. Right then, I've got a question here from a gentleman called Chris Gorey. The vocals in the backing vocals, guitars, harmonies on Let's Go sound as good today as they did on the Pyromania or the Hysteria days. How do Def Leppard manage to keep this up?
Talent.
We'd like to think that, but mostly it's practice. We actually practice a lot. I think it's dying, thankfully, but there's an urban myth that rock bands just sit around with their feet up drinking Jack Daniels and smoking cigarettes, and then they just wander on stage and perform. I'm sure they did in the 70s and the 80s, or the 60s and 70s rather. For those, it's such a demanding thing to sing some of these songs. You listen to the backing vocals that these guys have to blare out on Sugar and Rock of Ages and Armageddon and stuff like that. It's a lot of work. It's also a lot of harmony. So it's practice, and practice makes perfect. We've been doing it for a long time. We pride ourselves in the vocals. And so we do a lot of exercise, and we do a lot of rehearsals, so that when we do it on stage, unless we've got flu and colds, which happens, that can affect your voice big time. Pneumonia or influenza never affected the fingers of a guitar player, but they certainly affected his voice or a singer's voice. So, you know, that aside, we practice hard so that we sound as good as possible.
And it's like athletes these days. We were talking about this earlier as well. You know, it's so competitive at the higher levels that they have to practice. It's like a science. You have to commit to it, and that's what we do, and that's why it sounds that way, because that's why we sound like that live too. Eric Olson says, which of your guitars is your favorite? I go through kind of different kind of periods, but I play Jackson guitars, so Jackson PC1. One of those is my favorite, usually.
But not necessarily any specific
one. Yeah, because they're all different colors, and there's a natural one that's kind of really worn. And we have A rig, B rig, C rig. We've got stuff in Australia, on its way to Australia. We have different stuff in Japan, and we have a different bunch of guitars in our set than when we just played in America, London. So they're all different guitars anyway. So it's yeah, there's favourites among all of them.
There's lots of questions here, so bear with us. Okay, Simon Livesey, of all your albums, which one was the most enjoyable journey while making that album? Without doubt, this album has been the most fun, absolutely most fun. The first album that we did, On Through the Night, which Phil wasn't involved in, took about 16 days to record and was a great laugh because it was at John Lennon's old house in London, which then belonged to Ringo Starr, actually in Ascot. But this album, by far for us, the way we are right now, we had great fun making it. We were made it for all the right reasons. In other words, for the music, there was no record company involvement. We just made an album, and once it was finished, then we started worrying about how we're going to release it. But we just did this with nobody watching over us, just wrote some songs that we thought were great, and just went and had fun recording them. End of.
There you go. Do you guys know what Ninja Sex Party is? I don't know that, but anyway, that come up. But Sarah Moore says...
No, but I'd like to.
Yeah, me too.
I would like to know what a Ninja Sex Party is.
I've never heard it. It just came up there. It was some kind of, yeah. Sarah Moore says, Phil, do you have a cheat day with food, and what do you pig out on? Yes, I do. Travel days don't really count when you're on a plane and all that stuff, so you kind of end up eating bagels and nuts and all sorts of stuff. Now, try to eat healthy most of the time, but you can't beat salsa and Doritos. And there's only one vegan Dorito they do, which is it's a sweet chili, and they taste great, and they're really awful, but you just don't eat too many. So I do have pig out days. It's brilliant. I've got a dessert. We went to Real Food Day earlier in LA, which was killer. I've got a vegan cheesecake, which I'm going to pig out on later on today. So, yes.
If I haven't eaten it already.
There was that. I don't know where it went.
I've got one here from a lady called Sarah O. She wants to know what my favourite David Bowie album is. Great question. Impossible to answer because Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday will be a different album. But overall, it's going to be a toss-up between Hunky Dory and Ziggy Stardust. But actually right now, it's Aladdin Sane.
Aladdin Sane, I kind of keep going back to, I think, yeah. Pretty diverse. Oh, right, so. Will there be a Pyromania residency? I hope so. The Asteria one was fantastic, we loved it. So we'll see. When we get some time, we've got to promote the new album, which we're really excited about. We want to go as many places as we can. We've got Japan, Australia, Singapore, UK, US coming up. So, check those and we'll be out there. But whenever we get some time, we'll do that at some point.
Okay, Lauren Schmidt is asking, who takes the longest to get ready on stage? That's a good question, actually, because it depends what you mean by get ready.
Right.
Getting dressed, not him, because he only puts a pair of trousers on. Sav, isn't he?
Yeah, he does.
Sav would be he'll be the ponce in the band. He'd be the one that spends hours in front of the mirror and changing his shirt and deciding what to wear. Meanwhile, I just pick something, put it on, and then go and warm up. So, I think Sav takes the longest to get ready.
And someone asked here, along those lines, do you have any pre-show rituals? And I didn't think that we did, but then...
Burning the witch.
Yeah. But I think we do. You know, it's like we all have different things. I was doing this on some resin because during the summer my hands were so slippery and I got all oil, I have coconut oil, that's why I'm all shiny. So I have to have it because I dropped the guitar pick and my fingers were sliding off the fretboard because it was so hot this summer. So I was doing this thing like this on this resin that they put on like violin bows and like gymnasts use on their fingers, and there was a cameraman there and I'm doing this thing and he's like, is that a pre-show ritual? And I'm like, well, I guess it is.
Yeah,
I guess it is. So. As ridiculous as it is. So, yes, we do. We all do something
different. I've done vocal warm-ups that last forever, and we all do, actually. Yeah. We all join in, going la, 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 and that kind of stuff. But other than that, I mean, it would be nice to just listen to somebody else before we went on.
It would.
We're too busy getting ready to get inspired. So we just get in the room, get ready, and when we come off, we have rituals. We have a bit of snap, get on the bus, and then we watch TV like American Horror Story or Narcos.
We binge watch.
Yeah, we definitely binge watch. We say, in fact, we'll get up the next day and ask how long you stayed up and how many episodes you watched of a certain show. Walking Dead at the moment, that'd be the one.
That would, absolutely. Someone said, I could never be a vegan, I love my dead animals. If you've got a dog, perhaps we can come round and kill that one and chow down on that.
With the fur still attached.
Absolutely, yeah. Mm. So send
everybody to the wrong.
Send your puppy in, we chow down.
John Carroll says, are you still planning on re-recording the back catalogue to release on iTunes? Bit by bit, we may do. I mean, it's not a major issue at the moment because we've got a new album out today. We're way more interested in releasing new music than rehashing old. The only reason we did the three re-records that we've done was specific. We did Rock of Ages and Sugar because they were both featured in the movie Rock of Ages. And we did Hysteria to celebrate the Viva Hysteria residency in Vegas. So, we'll do a few more down the road if we don't get this contractual stuff sorted out with our ex-record label. But the new stuff is the main focus at the moment.
Can you guys settle with Unum? As you were saying that came up, can you settle with
Unum? Well, we can, but ball's in their court. So, you know, apparently, I think the word is, I'm not allowed to say anymore unless my lawyer says so.
So should we take some of these?
Okay,
we'll take a couple of these. Here it goes then, Phil. Check mine, yeah.
It's going too fast.
I know. How did the Tesla song? I've just been up recording with Tesla, actually, producing a new song. And it's great. They're such a great band. They're going to be touring with us again, certainly in the new year. So we've got some shows booked already. So yeah, that song was great, and the guys are amazing. Whose vocals on We Belong? The song which we all do a thing. We can have a competition. You tell us who's singing what on the song We Belong, and we'll give you a present, maybe.
Well, that'll take you about 2 minutes to answer because it says so in the lyric book.
Does it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Scrub that.
You get
absolutely nothing. So, well, then don't ask questions like that. You tell us who's singing.
I've got one here from a person whose name I can't pronounce. Umo.
Anyway.
Yes. Somebody's asking me here, Umo, I think the first name is, what's the favourite non-Def Leppard album cover? That's a great question. That's going to be a toss-up between the original version of a Satanic Majesty's Request, which was...
Yanked, right?
It was... No, the one that's... that twists... What do you know? It moves.
Oh, the hologram.
Hologram type thing. Sergeant Pepper doesn't suck. But actually, my favourite is Captain Fantastic and the Brown Bear Cowboy by Elton John, because it's just an amazing piece of art. It's beautiful, absolutely beautiful.
Someone asked if we had to talk Rick Allen into singing. Yes, because here's the thing. Rick Allen can sing and do brilliant impersonations. He's got a really good voice. But a few years ago, you remember we needed four harmonies? So we assigned a microphone to Rick Allen so he could do this crucial fourth part harmony. Because Joe singing lead vocal, me, Viv and Sav doing a three part and this fourth part. Rick Allen did sing great. Started singing this thing, we rehearsed him, and then about after 2 days, the mic's over here and he's not even singing. So yeah, you may have a word with him, perhaps, but he does sing good.
He's a great mimic.
He is.
And so anybody that can do a good mimic can sing, and he can sing, but he just doesn't want to, you know. And Charlie Watts could probably sing too, but he doesn't want to.
I want to hear it. We good?
Yeah.
So I think we're getting the rap, and we got to go, guys.
Really?
Yeah, so okay. We can
one
do
more.
We
don't
one
more. One
more each.
What is your favourite sweet song?
Really?
Well,
we've recorded two of them,
haven't we? We did Action, and we've done
Hellraiser.
Hellraiser's pretty good. I like Set Me Free off
Love Set Me Free.
It's like Deep Purple.
Blockbuster's great.
Ballroom Blitz. Yeah. Sweet's Greatest Hits is Sweet's best song. There you go.
Why is he so shy about it? So you'd have to ask him, but my thing is he gets a bit carried away with this drum playing lark. So he kind of forgets that he's supposed to be singing.
Yeah, he's a bit of a good drummer, really, when you think about it.
So he does. So we kind of let him off. We let him have that, and no fourth part harmony.
The four of us will survive. So
what is the most song to perform?
Maybe the most difficult song to perform, I'm supposed to say.
Well, here's the thing. So when we done Love Bites, it became we'd never recorded, we'd never played it live as a band. Album comes out, single comes out, it goes to number one in the Billboard charts. And we've never played it, so we're like, we have to learn how to play it. It was so hard
to figure out like guitar parts, all the harmonies, who's going to sing what. And it was just really difficult.
And we had 3 days to do it.
Yeah. And we rehearsed this thing, kind of got it down, a bit scary, but now we do it in our sleep. So
And in fairness, it's been a lot easier to do since Vivian joined the band, because Vivian sings a lot more than Steve ever did, bless him. So vocally, it went up another notch when Viv joined.
Right. I love Jay Wick's answer. It's been a million times. Oh, horrendous now. Yes, very sad. Jay Wick is this place in England. It's kind of where people from London would go on vacation. It's where the Thames estuary goes into the sea. And it's horrible, really. But yeah. I used to go as a kid and it was brilliant. But it's like really dilapidated and nasty. It is. It's horrible.
You need somebody like you to renovate the area.
I think we should play there.
Colin Towers.
Jay Wick. Yeah. Colin Towers.
Yeah. I just saw one fly by there and said, are you looking forward to playing Dublin? I am definitely looking forward to playing Dublin. Because, A, it's my adopted hometown for the last 30 years. B, I can get out of bed, go down and sound check, play the gig, get in the cab, go back to bed, get up the next day, drive to Belfast, do a gig, drive back down to Dublin, go to bed, enjoy my son's birthday, and then fly to Newcastle for the rest of the tour. So,
not bad.
Absolutely, really looking forward to Dublin. Plus, it's going to be the first gig of the British-Irish tour, so, you know, that's always exciting.
Now, Finley's birthday's a day after mine.
Yeah, it is, but we're having to, it's on the 10th, but I'm having to celebrate it on the 8th.
My birthday.
Yeah. So, happy birthday, Phil.
Thank you.
And happy birthday, Finley.
But on that note,
I think it's time for us to go.
Yeah.
Anyway, hope you enjoyed what we've just done. We've never done Periscope before, so we are novices at this. Hope it wasn't too painful. What am I saying here? We will come back to Canada. Yes, we're looking forward to Dublin. Is my son going to the Dublin show? Maybe. Don't know.
So, Rick, happy birthday. Not yet.
We'll
almost. When is it? 2 days.
Play. No.
No.
Love you, Joe. Love you too.
Happy Halloween tomorrow. Then it's Rick Allen's birthday.
Yeah.
Wow. It's all
really, seriously, this is fantastic. Is look at this. That's all your bubbles, your heart bubbles and stuff, which is cool. We've never done Periscope. I'm sure we will do it again. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thanks for the support and listen to the new album. It's really good.
Cheers. Thank you. Bye.
See ya.